days we have a small gathering, first of this kind, discussing about street photography in Mangalore. I'm really thankful to Diesel Cafe for providing this opportunity. Like, so, all of you guys, would you like to introduce yourself?
I'm Jason. I'm a YouTuber. I'm a person.
My name is Rahul. I work as a guest lecturer and I teach television.
I'm Prajit and I work for print office.
I'm Vivek Shetty, studying actually.
So most of you guys we have met before, except this new year. And I'm glad there is somebody from film and television to interact with us today. So this was done in association with, we have a small community for street photographers. We call it Streets of Mangalore. Okay, so this is the only street photography community in Mangalore. Okay, we operate through Instagram, Facebook. We have an email if you guys like to send any inquiries. So we display pictures which are shot by contributors who are generously contributing to this cause, and we want to encourage, our aim is to encourage street photography in the city. Okay. And eventually we want to have a gallery in the city displaying all these contributors' pictures. In addition to that, on a regular basis, we have photo meets, photo walks, street photography, and this is the first time we are having some discussion like this. So today we are going to introduce street photography to you. What it is, why we do it, some techniques involved in that, some laws related to that. And the premise of the whole discussion is storytelling with street photography. So just an image, it's true, it's just 2D image, you see it on the screen, you see it in a print. But what do you want to tell when you click an image in the street? So I'll be talking about the introduction part. I'll tell you what is street photography and what we can shoot as subjects in street photography. And Kirthan, who runs Streets of Mangalore with me, he will talk to you about some of the techniques in street photography and laws related to that. So any layperson, when he thinks of street photography, he will probably first go to Wikipedia. So Wikipedia says, street photography, sometimes called candid photography, is conducted for art or inquiry. It's not a commercial thing. There is nothing called a commercial street photographer. You might never hear that term. It's mostly done for art and or inquiry. So it features unmediated chance encounters and random incidents within public places. So all this is very, very, very restricted. What Wikipedia says is very restricted. In general, a street photography can be anything. It's a range from, say, photojournalism on one end to street portraits and even street fashion on the other end. So everything in between comes in street photography. We will see how vast it is when you see the subjects that we can shoot in street photography. So it does not necessitate the presence of street or urban environment. That's completely true. I agree with that. You don't have to go out exclusively on the streets to street shoot street photography. So street photography is nothing new. It's as old as photography itself. That's because the first cameras which were introduced could shoot only at a bright light. So they could only shoot outdoors, and they could, the exposure duration was so long that any person who is not moving will not be, any person who is not moving will be in the picture. Everybody else will not be the picture. So basically they were just shooting buildings and streets. So street photography is way back when. But there are many things in street photography which have changed over the years. The most important one is, like, who is a street photographer? If you go back to the 19th century, a street photographer was a guy who stands on street corners at important buildings, beaches, temples. They take your photograph, they give you a print, or later on Polaroid, they used to Polaroid. They charge you for it. People used to call them street photographers. But in the modern contemporary sense, when you think of street photographers, you think of people with compact cameras. They're moving through the crowd, trying to be unnoticed, trying to capture moments, random, unmediated moments that we saw. That's how street photography has, you know, the definition has changed over the years. Probably the first book on street photography was in 1877. It was called Street Life in London. There are other things which have changed over the years. I'm not boring with the name of street photographers, their techniques and something. But the changes which have been very significant in street photography include uses of monochrome film to digital and use of color in street photography. There are purists who believe that street photography should be shot only on black and white or monochrome. They believe that there should be no editing. There are contemporary artists who look for compositions, who look for art, who look for colors, who look for patterns in street photography. That's what is contemporary, classic to contemporary. That shift has been very significant in street photography. So that's about the history part. Why people will do a street photography? This image, by the way, was shot, I don't know, 2011 or something, on my phone. This is a street near Narayana Hotel in Mumbai. So why somebody wants to shoot street photography? Okay. So let me ask you, how many of you write in journals, diaries? Okay. You guys have heard that people write it. Street photography is something like journaling. It's a very personal experience. Most street photographers don't care about who is seeing their photos, about what's happening to their photos. They don't care about anything. Most of them want to either document their life, and there are some artistic people who wanted to preserve history. Like, so this is a chance where street photographers have been hired to preserve history. Okay. Many of the early photographs were pictures of markets, streets, buildings coming up. There are so many people, like for example, when there was a terrorist attack on World Trade Center in New York City, when it went down, that site zero, that region was a restricted area. Nobody could go there. But there was this one street photographer, I forget his name. He identified that this has to be documented. He went to the proper authorities, got all the licenses, set up cameras all over the region. He has the whole time lapse of the building coming up and people working there, their emotions of other people who came to all the memorials around the building. So that is documenting life and preserving history. Some people in the past, they have shot street photography only for future glory. Like they just wanted to, they never published their images. They became popular only after they died. So those are all part of our rich history now. That's part of our history because they wanted to document. But practically speaking, like for us, day-to-day people, they can gain a lot by street photography by improving their skills and portfolio. When you go out into the streets, you don't know what's going to happen. Who's going to come? How's the light? What's the kind of framing you're doing? You don't know anything. You have to make snap decisions. And that, the process which goes on in your mind, that will train your mind to recognize these frames, patterns. Somebody called it decisive moments and all that. Okay, so there are so many such words. So that will improve your portfolio and skill, which will get you hired. These skills, candid photography skills, will get you hired. You can even sell these images. But there is a caveat, if there is any recognizable person or property in the image, you cannot sell it in stock photography. You can only sell it for editorial photography. Editorial which comes in newspapers, bulletins, journals, stuff like that. Otherwise, if there are no recognizable people or property, you can sell it for stock photography. And in fact, my first job as a professional photographer was as an event photographer. I shot for an event called India Surf Festival for 3 years in a row. So, I will show you some of the pictures which I have. This can get you jobs. That's the practical aspect of why you want to do street photography. You want to own your skills. So, now let's talk about like what you shoot in street photography. What do you think we shoot in street photography?
Monuments.
Museums. People. What do you think?
Patterns.
What about you? What do you concentrate on? Framing. So, I will not ask Kirthan. He will tell you what he likes to shoot. So, basically, the choice of subject is again very personal. So, I will not tell you shoot this, and this is street photography. It's very wide. I told you in the comment, it's very wide. So, let's just see the categories of subjects which you can shoot. So I like to categorize in three things. One is extraordinary subjects, extraordinary frames, okay, extraordinary moments in time. These are rare. They are hard to come by, and when you, like, you have shot 1,000 pictures, maybe you have one extraordinary image which you want to remember. Then there are mundane images. I love this. This is what I go out in streets. I look for mundane things. I want to document life. This is my prerogative. But there is one more thing which I also like. Looking for the extraordinary in the moment. So you can convert your mundane images into extraordinary by doing certain things. Right? I'll tell you what. I will give you some examples. I will show you what. But what is extraordinary and what is mundane? That definition is governed by, it is colored by a person's experiences and the person's perspective. These are the two things. For you and I, something may be extraordinary, but for some other person, that may be mundane. So for example, this image, this is the Taj in Mumbai. Yeah? I was just there photographing the crowd, and I noticed this sunset poking through both the buildings. This was extraordinary for me, but people living there, they see it every day, so they may not think it is extraordinary. Yeah? So you can shoot buildings, you can shoot people, crowds of people. So those are supports. And this I shot I think this was in Maldives on a boat jetty. I was just walking on the jetty, and this cat is trying to pounce on these birds. And I was there at the right moment to take the picture when all the birds flew in. It was a chance. It's rare. Okay. So this is something I would call extraordinary. Right? And this was like, it looks very, very mundane. But for me it was extraordinary because I've never seen this kind of art. This was shot in a remote village at 16,000 feet somewhere in Ladakh. I was surprised that this kind of art was there. So that made it something extraordinary for me. So you might shoot street art as a subject for your street photography. This is a mundane image, I agree. But it was shot in a shop where there is nothing on 300 kilometers on either side of the shop. Okay, so this is like survival. That's that. To remember that, I shot this image. Very mundane thing. How people, if you compare 100 shops, there will be complete differences between them. That was what going on in my mind when I shot. People crossing streets, like the buildings in a particular city, how do they dress? This is all documentary kind of things which goes through my mind when I go out shooting. These are the subjects which I look for as a mundane subject. Some interesting buildings. Some random still life images. Okay. This is CSK in Mumbai, right side corner. Okay. The crowds which go through the places. These are all subjects. Now this was shot over the bridge after Kulai, after that near Padambur. That bridge. This is early morning, like 5:30 or 6. These are sand loaders. Most people don't know where the sand is coming, which they are building their houses with. And I didn't know until I saw this. Then I asked everybody to go there. I came to know that people are getting sand in their tiny boats. It's something extraordinary for me. And I was there at 6 o'clock in the morning. I was there for some other reason. But I was lucky enough to get that shot. Now this was shot. I shot this because it reminded me of a story. Interesting one. We read it in school. Like, one woman is dying of pneumonia. It's a cold area with snowing at night, and there was a painter who has never done anything like awesome in his life. But that woman decides that once the last leaf from the plant falls off, I will die. And this painter decides he does not want to let her die. So overnight, in the snow, in the dark, in the cold, he paints a leaf on the wall outside. The woman's apartment is opposite to this. She sees the leaf, and that gives her energy to live on. But the painter dies of pneumonia. So I saw this image in Delhi, and I was like, I have to capture that. So it, the perspective and experiences colors your like what makes it extraordinary. So some people practicing their dance moves. This is Padambur Beach. I was lucky to be there to capture these things. These are all the various subjects you can do. Fortunately, you can convert or progress your mundane images into extraordinary images. So you need to see a few things. I will show you an example, like this one. This is the previous one is also a railway station. It looks quite mundane, but to my eye, this looks extraordinary. The thing which I am using here is called juxtaposition. There are many things in this frame. The time, the leading lines, the silhouettes, the person pausing right at the moment where the sun is right in the middle of the walkway. That juxtaposition made this extraordinary. I shot like 15-20 images waiting for this moment. Most of street photography is waiting. Many people pass, but at that time I called it sun behind bars, but they call it whatever. So this image, for example, this was shot in Mangalore party. It's nice, I see people are enjoying and all that. But I use this experience to shoot this image in ISF. I waited for the moment, and at that moment you see that the expression of the person without a face. You don't always have to shoot faces. Expression of the person without a face. You are showing the environment, the silhouette. Okay? There are a lot of things which can be conveyed through a single frame. So that's the story. You build up the story by using juxtaposition. Composition elements are there, but you have to build up a story. He will tell you more things like where, which kind of techniques you can use. So can you identify this monument or that? Anybody? You'll be surprised if I tell you what that is. That's the Minar. It's the Minar of Taj Mahal. The perspective matters. Everywhere. So that was some kind of a fair in Singapore. I waited for that. That's a very nice decorative path. But I waited for somebody to come into the frame. This last one is Bandstand. People go deep into the sea at low tide. They enjoy it. So it's documentation of what they are trying to do. Wait for the person, reflection, silhouette, time of the day. There are many elements. This is Charminar in Hyderabad. I could have just shot the frames. I did shoot those things as an architectural viewpoint. But these people, the wonder of those people in the frame, looking at the rest of the monument, that's the story that I'm trying to tell through this image. This was again shot at ISF. You can use different techniques to accentuate your story. He's a fire dancer, he's a street performer, this is another subject, interesting subject for street photography. I used a slow shutter speed, it was a handheld shot. But my favorite subject of all time is people. I'm biased that way. I always shoot people in the street. Okay, so like this image was not easy to come back. So before this image, to get these people to laugh so much, I was shooting so many things, they were following me around. This is my mother's village actually. All these kids were following me around. And before this shot, we did this. Okay, so when you interact with your people, you get way better images. Purists will believe that you should not talk to people on the street when you do street photography. But contemporary street photographers, you can talk. All those purists who said they never talk to people on the street, they are lying. Because those cameras were so slow that the movement could not be captured in that moment. They had to ask the people to pose. There was some interaction involved. Okay. So, but it is still sort of unmediated. In that moment, in that place, on the spot, you are making those decisions to pose them in such a way. That is what the street photography is all about. This is Comic Con in Bangalore. This is a friend's function. Guy was really good. Kids were playing around, laughing, making noise, but he was good. I thought it was interesting. It does tell you. So you can make some even some intentional images in street photography. You can do long exposures. This is still like I wanted to show the crowd how crowded it is during the festivities in that temple. So you can use different techniques. This is called a human billboard. It's a common practice. This lady was just standing there looking at her phone. She's actually advertising for a shoe company. This is in Sydney, it's a shoe company. All the people are passing by. So if you wait for the right frame and the right opportunity, you will tell a better story. I could have just shot this shopping mall, but the shoppers in that, coming at the right point where the lines are leading, all that. You don't always have to show the person to tell a story. Like, this kid is obviously enjoying himself. You don't have to see his face to know that. One of my all-time favorite street photographs. This is again in Nubra Valley in Ladakh. they love street dogs. Feed them, it's very nice. Even the dogs are very funny, very nice. Selling people are very easy. Very friendly. In India, that's the thing, like, people are very friendly. You don't have to worry so much. This is a person relaxing outside a mall in Bangkok. I always felt that I was comfortable shooting people whom I don't know. For obvious reasons. I felt comfortable. But many people feel nervous going out of like their city or something. But it was the opposite for me. When I went out of India, I was more comfortable shooting people. No. I didn't ask him for permission. This was shot without permission. They're just relaxing outside. I love this bike activity. That is the thing which attracted me to this guy. So this was also not without permission, but I bought the sweets from this guy. This is in Manali. It's that you know, that Malai Jamun, yummy like. I waited for him to serve me that, and that time I shot. So you can do various things to tell a story. Then obviously, when you look at this, you know the environment. You know the what's happening. You know that there's a transaction happening. You know there's a young guy who's trying to make money selling his food. That's the story here. Can you guess what's happening here? So somewhere near Kasagur, I just looked down from the bridge. People are praying on the way to Sabarimala. It doesn't have to, if you can't tell a story in one frame, you don't have to worry about it. Like, make multiple frames. Make a collage. Like, I met this kid, this is in Kesagade Medical Academy. They have a basketball court. He was practicing his skating over there. This time I asked him. Yeah. But I shot multiple images. I wanted to show that he was practicing in some place, trying to build up his skill. What's the story in this? Can anybody say? Think of something. A place to relax, chill out. There are no people, there are no buildings, there is no street. But still, it could be considered as street photography, and you can still tell a story. The time of day, the shade, doesn't have a pillow or a veil of hay. It's a place to relax for somebody. There are other digital ways in which you can tell a story. Like this was a double exposure made in Photoshop later. I knew this is Kapu, like I wanted. This was already in my mind before I shot the images. I wanted to juxtapose the height of this lighthouse against the breadth of the beach. So you can tell stories in various ways. But the thing is, you have to be always open to anything that can be in street photography, hypervigilant. You should always be hypervigilant. If you love observing people, if you love observing things, what's happening, you will become better and better at street photography. This could have been a mundane image of a guy having coffee, but in the presence of this amazing culture, it became an extraordinary image. This image was shot at ISS. It was a candid image, but surprisingly, that man is looking all the opposite direction to that in the background. There is some story there. It is disinterested. This image got published in many magazines, Germany, USA. They all wanted to feature India Surf Festival. This image went all the way. This, of course, comes from that. One of the best times to do street photography in Mangalore is during festivals. Amazing. Like, people do not realize the potential in the city. And I have some favorite subjects. Like, even people, I like to shoot people through the glass. I like to shoot people without their faces. Portraits without faces. So this is one of the examples of shooting through the glass. I made a small like a time lapse of that. I like to shoot reflection. These are my three favorite things. Everybody has their own favorite things to tell a story. So you can even tell a story in various formats. So this is one which I made. It's a zine. This is all the Sydney photographs. I wanted to show the work day in Sydney. What people go through during work day. This is very few images. There are no words inside it. Just a small index which tells you what are the images about. So you can tell a story in various ways in street photography. Now, Kirthan will tell you more about like what are the techniques you can use in street photography. What are the laws related to it. If anybody wants one of the copies of these, let me know.
Good evening. Well, I'm Kirthan and I also go by the name monsoon. And why is that? There's a different story for that. I'll tell you about that some other day. Okay, make a picture. There are three main things: a story, a composition, and a feeling. These are the main three things that we get to make a picture that tells us that you can feel. You don't have to explain it, it's self-explaining. Composition is something that is not started with the photography, it started with the paintings. When it started maybe 15th, 16th century, I think that's the time when painting started. They have tried and tested all sorts of frames, and I'll be talking about it later. Story. To make a picture, there should be a story. If you just click a wall, clean blank wall, it doesn't tell a story. If you put a subject in it, and he has an expression or movement or the thing that he is doing, that's the story, and creativity is the toughest part of photography. That is something you have to work upon. It may be anything, it may be the angle, it may be the time, it may be how you focus your image. Whether you want to focus on the subject or the foreground, that is kind of creating. Composition. Okay, I'll be talking about a few basic compositions. Just the basic, there are many types of compositions. But in the basic, this will make a difference. If you follow these rules, it's going to make a huge difference. First one, rule of thirds. If you divide the frame by two horizontal and two vertical lines, the point of intersection, if we keep the subject in any point of these intersections, that will make your image a lot better. It's not even this style of composition came from the painting itself, because we have tried it and human brains are configured in such a manner. We frame a subject in these intersection lines, intersection points, the eyes will directly go into it. We will start seeing that picture. There are four random pictures and one picture with rule of thirds. The person will look at this one. And then there is one more thing for rule of thirds. If the person is facing towards, always keep the subject facing inwards. If there's a movement, keep it inwards the same. So if this person is doing this makeup for the extra manner, I've kept it at the facing towards the frame, not outside. You can keep it outside of the frame if you want to do an emotion. Emotion of sadness. You can make sure that it's inwards the other side. And if you look at that kid, he's quite happy and there's a movement, he's going towards the left. You always capture towards the left, not towards the right. And this is something I've found out. I don't know how legit it is or how we can. The eye focuses on 41%. That's what the research says, 25%, 14%, 20%. I don't think that's going to make any difference unless you keep a subject in these points of intersecting at all two points. And there's one more, centered composition and symmetry. This is what you have to do. You have to keep the subject in the middle, in the center, and look for the symmetry. Even if there is no symmetry in that, you could keep it in the center. Even if it's used in architecture or portraits, if you're taking a portrait to the center, make sure the eyes are straight towards the lens, because the eyes makes a lot of difference. Frame within a frame, you have to search for the patterns. If you see, we are seeing this glass, you can see a glass behind you, and just one more frame behind that, you can keep through this rather than going in different angles. Such examples,
other big app included in Hyderabad, Golconda, there was a small opening. It's a tiny opening. In this picture, it looks huge, but it's a very small opening to which app included. And this is shot in Afghanistan, and I guess, I don't know the name of the dollar. Leading lines, so there's a subject, or it may be an answer too. If you see a line which is passing towards within the frame, from the edge of the frame, or is the edge and which leads to the subject, or just which goes towards the subject, not intersecting with the subject, it may go towards the subject. Negative space. People don't realize it, but mostly what I've seen, people do use this thing, but they don't realize they are using it. Negative space, which isolates the subject from the entire crowd. And always, this is used to mainly to isolate the subject. If you want to tell a single story, not a lot of them, a single story, you may use this. Okay, this is the boring part. Laws related to photography in India, which is literally none. There is no written law for photography in India. So now it's all the grey area. Everything is in the grey, there is no black law. Okay, these are the guidelines, which is mainly used in by most of the photography clubs. The first one, anyone in public place can take picture of anything you want. Public place includes parks, sideways, malls. Malls. In Mangalore, what happens is you can shoot in mobile phones, but not with the DSLRs, they won't allow it. And they may have their own tools, but you can't argue with them because it's a private property. If you are on a public property, you can use pictures of private property. Okay, this is a simple one. If you are in a bar and you can see a private building or a statue, which is a private, you own. Or it's playing on a private property, you can click it somewhere, it's nothing wrong with that. So, sensitive ball and buildings can be doing photography, which is deemed as a threat to national security. Majority of official buildings or government buildings, they don't allow photography inside for the security reasons, and this is India. Because there is a lot of clouds in the government buildings and that can be a potential threat to the security too. People can be photographed if they are in public without them or things unless they have reduced themselves and can expect a reasonable degree of privacy. This is the most debatable thing. If you are taking a picture, just make sure they have clicked it and walked away. If that person is concerned, if he walks towards you and asks, what are you doing? You are not obliged to answer them, but politely in India you could just answer them what you are doing. Take their permission. If they haven't noticed this, that you are taking a picture, just click and walk away. That's not going to make any sense. But you can't publish it if their people are feeling particularly. If they are in the subject, if they are taken as a subject, you can't publish it for the problem. Although security is often given under you, somebody doesn't know these things before they are banned. Okay, this is the same thing I'm talking about. They usually say that for the security reason, this mainly happens when you're clicking a picture of their kids.
And even in
are quite taking pictures of kids are quite sensitive. For it depends on the state and the city. If you are going to go and taking pictures, that's a different state. Like people in that city are used to pictures of camera. They go out in Mangalore, they are just getting used to it. Because we have experienced it in our few photo walk sessions. Because people haven't seen that people coming with cameras and this is something new. They have to make sure they get comfortable. valid treatment while you are waiting there. Still, if they aren't sure you should be publishing it, just be known or delete it in front of them. You need to take many other things too. The next is if you are telling you don't have to explain why. The same thing, it's about the, how polite can you be. You are not under the law, you are not required to answer it, but out of politeness, always please to answer what you are doing. Private parties have very limited rights in this public opinion. Nobody goes into private parties, what I have heard. And even if they can't be in, and even in the public, not even private parties, this happened 3 months ago, I don't remember when this happened. A photographer was taken in Mumbai. This was in the time of Ganapati research, and he was taken and taken up. Public cannot be taken and they can't go and just take your camera, neither your flashlight, they can't take your phone. Only if you want, you can do it. It's all about Instagram. What I have to think about, what I think. This PR art is not a photographer. There are two things that you need to follow or not follow. Realize it by yourself to be an artist. Shoot for yourself, not for Instagram, not for someone, not for you to get a like or views. Just shoot it for yourself. You don't need to go to somewhere. You just have to be yourself and just bring it out. So if you are happy with your picture, that's more than enough. You don't have to make someone else happy. Let the moment. What happens is everybody is there. You find that these days. If you go to a photo wall, what I'm noticing, everyone is holding a camera right in the front of your face. They aren't feeling the moment. They aren't seeing that. There is a rally going on, or a parade, or a festival. They aren't feeling that. It's just that they want to capture. Blow your camera, look at it, wait for that right moment. You could also feel it and capture the right moment. When your camera is below you, you will be feeling that every moment that's going on. You will be aware of a lot of things. In the viewfinder, you will only focus on the frame. Showing you, not the moments. Be creative, that's the hardest part. Always be creative, what you want to do. It may strike at any moment, creativity may be anything. So always focus on that. Don't stay focus on it, let the moment. That's the part you have to focus on. Creativity will be that behind you. Meet people. People, these days, everyone. Nobody is going out meeting people, or everybody wants to get the suggestions on through the Instagram or through the messaging or any other mediums. See, the experience what we are having here, we only are into Instagram message, DM or WhatsApp DM. Always meet people, you might find various ideas, you may know various things, even in the streets. People just click and run. That's not gonna help me with any manners. I love to meet people. I'm more oriented street portraits. I go sit, talk to them, make them comfortable enough, and click them. And there are moments you might be clicking them, but that picture won't be good enough. You have to wait for that candid moment when they will be smiling, they will be looking somewhere else. You have to capture that moment. Patience. I have a friend of mine, he came from Hyderabad, he went to Kochi for a tryout and he came back and he went back to Kolkata, I guess, and he went back to Hyderabad. And the pictures he got was zero. He spent so much money and he didn't even get a single proper picture. He might have clipped a lot of pictures, but he hasn't got a single picture that has satisfied him. It's all about the patience. You have to wait for that perfect moment. For a photographer, this that one picture that could make its life. You have to wait for that perfect moment and visualization. That's the main part of photography. Street photography, you have to visualize. In any form of photography, you have to visualize a thing that is gonna happen before it's gonna happen. I've taken this in Kundapur. This was 2018. I went for a pre-wedding. I think it was not even pre-wedding. An engagement shoot. They had a nataka, Yakshagana nataka. They were getting started with their makeup and all other stuff. So I went in there, tried to live. They were not comfortable. So I've just waited, I just started speaking towards them, just roam around them. Once they get comfortable, click something else, don't click them directly. Click something else, let them know what you are doing, let them be comfortable enough, then you can start clicking them. This was in Panambur, maybe 2016, I guess. No, this was in 1980. went for a long exposure, which I did. Yeah, but this guy sat there. He wasn't even moving a bit. So I tried to capture him, and this is what I have got. This is from the recent photo walk in the street from Bandar. This person was walking towards me. He looked at me, clicking other people. He was curious enough to see what are the pictures I have been clicking. So I clicked the picture of him and showed it to him. It wasn't that good enough. I felt good. I felt bad showing him a bad picture of him. I asked him, can I click a picture of him, one more picture of you? And he didn't speak a word. He didn't speak a word for the entire till I walked out. He didn't even speak a word. He just gave that subtle smile. It showed it had a different kind of pain in those eyes. He gave that smile. I clicked that picture. I think it's one of I felt this picture more than any of the pictures I have clicked before. But this was the moment where I felt I was connected to that person. This is not a candid picture. This is the one framed picture, but it tells you a story. It really a very awesome picture. It's not necessary that it should be a candid picture. It could be anything. You can frame it. But if that tells a story, that's good enough. Okay, I'll be talking about how I do my portrait photography. First thing, what I do whenever I reach a location, I just walk through everything. I won't open up my camera or just start shooting. I just walk a bit, look at my surroundings, and I make sure they notice me. Let them notice that I am there. And then I take out my camera and start clicking other things to make sure that they aren't surprised at what this guy is doing or feel like a turtle. Whenever you catch them, they'll just back off or just go inside. Let them feel comfortable. Go start speaking to them. Then click them. Click few pictures. Trust me, you won't be getting a perfect picture at the first time. You may get or you may not get. But once you have started clicking them, lower your camera. You don't have to look at them. You just lower towards your chin. Make sure the focus is always there. If you are just lowering from here to here, it's always the focus would be always there. It might change a bit, but it will be focused. Wait for that perfect moment when they will be smiling or will be candid or open towards you, not backing up in their fireworks and all those things. Make sure this was clicked in Sultan Bathe. This guy was painting the ship. I went there, I stood there for 5 minutes. He was still painting. He asked me, what are you doing? Where are you from? Once we started speaking, I asked him to pose for us. And he did. This was the sixth picture, not the first picture. This was the sixth picture that happened. This is from the same series that I spoke about in the last spring. These are the portraits from a few photo walks from the last year and this year. At the end, all these rules, all these laws, doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is what do you want us to show, what do you want to tell, and it's your story and it's your way to tell that story.
Thank you for listening. If you have any questions, we will take them. Anybody has tried street photography? I know that we wait for us. Anybody else? Try going all into this great shooting stuff. Why you did this? That's my why you did this. Not interested in that. enough. Never felt like documenting. Or are you afraid?
Afraid more than that.
Some people are afraid. But that's natural. Like, I remember, like, the first thing which I thought was screen, because I didn't know anything about using DSLR when I bought it. I was a phone photographer for a long time. And I started using the DSLR. So what I did was go out and decide my favorite place was a market. People are always hiding. The market is easy, you can get my chance there. So for market, I made a series of images. That got published in a few blogs. I wanted to record some pictures in that. I was not in it. So that's how I overcame the fear. I think what Kirthan says, talking to people will definitely renew that fear. I think you should try something. If you want to look up some street photographers in India, my inspiration was a guy called Ashok Sarman. I'm not sure you have heard of him. From Chennai. He used to shoot a lot of his street portraits on Marina Beach. That was his playground. He shot all the festivals, interacting with people. So that actually influenced me a lot when I was getting into photography. And street photography, my street photography interest stemmed from there. There are many other popular people who do street photography. That guy was my inspiration. So if you are interested, I ask you to come join us in Streets of Mangalore. We will be doing more photo works soon. And if you have your pictures, if you'd like us to share with our community, that is, send us an email or email us by talking to us. We do that. Even if you have a private profile, you can do that. And we are hoping to do a gallery next year. The dates are not fixed, but we have set a time frame of 1 year. So if you guys have any resources, contacts, info which would help us, we would greatly appreciate it if you could get in touch. If you have any friends, please press the message to them. We want to encourage more street photographers. I hope some of you will at least try some street photography after that. We have seen so many examples of what we can do. I hope you try it for the best work. Any more questions? We are still here for a while. You can. Thank you very much. Thanks.